to read a few passages of scripture and just get right in this tonight. Matthew chapter 9 and verse number 9. And Jesus passed forth from there, and he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the receipt of custom. And he said unto him, follow me. And he arose and followed him. And it came to pass, as Jesus sat at meat in the house, or in Matthew's house, behold, many publicans, or tax collectors, and sinners came, watch very carefully, and sat down with Jesus and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw it, they said unto his disciples, why does your master eat with publicans and sinners? But when Jesus heard that, he said unto them, they that be whole need not a physician, but they that are sick. But go and learn what this means. I will have mercy and not sacrifice, for I am not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Now, I prayed for you. Will you allow me to pray for me? Thank you very much. Father, I thank you for strengthening me tonight and helping me to articulate the announcements of heaven for every person's destiny in this building. I ask you, Lord, to allow me to say things I didn't study to say. I ask that the Holy Spirit speak through me tonight and speak to your people. I yield myself to you, Lord, and I say, have your way in me tonight. And I thank you, God, that there's an open heaven over this sanctuary, and revelation will run its course in each of our hearts. In Jesus' name. And everyone said amen. Amen. I want to point out a few things about this passage of scripture very quickly before I get into the lesson itself. First of all, in Matthew chapter 9 and verses 9 through 13, it's a beautiful setup for where he's going. When you look at the first few verses of this particular text, the Bible says that Jesus went from there where he was, which is a very interesting place that he had visited, and I won't take time to dialogue about that tonight. We'll do it next week. But he moves on to the seashore, and he finds a man named Matthew. And the Bible, very specifically, Carlos, calls him a tax collector. Now, the reason why the Bible would do that is because he would be known as a tax collector among his peers. So don't get him confused with another Matthew. So he says, Matthew the tax collector. And he says two words to him. Follow me. That's the call. And the call is an accosting. It's an arresting. It's God saying, here's your opportunity. Oh, when I thought about that today in my office, I thought how powerful the call of God is. And I can hear him daily calling to people. Follow me. My way is the best way. Follow me. Take up your cross and follow me. Did he not say that? And I love the fact that all 12 apostles, I believe, initially qualified themselves for the following by what they did when he spoke. Because all 12 of them laid down something, but they didn't just lay it down. They laid it down immediately and followed him. I believe that God is looking for people to follow him that are hungry to follow him. Is that enough said about that? There has to be something about our appetite. There has to be something about our desire. Like David said, my soul longs for you. As the deer pants after the water brook, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. In other words, I want to be with you and in your presence more than any other place in this earth. And how easy is it for men to drop occupation to follow a Savior? And you see that in all 12 of these apostles. And the Bible says Matthew dropped what he was doing at the seat of customs and followed him. Very powerful. And guess where Jesus went? Straight to his house. But he didn't go by himself. He invited other people like Matthew. Tax collectors. Now, tax collectors had a reputation because they were a little sneaky. That when they took the tax from the people. Now, here's why they weren't liked among Jews. And I'll just set this up and move on. But tax collectors were not liked among Jews because they were Jews working for Rome. And they were taking more from their own people than they should be taking. So they were skimming off the top. So they weren't liked among Jews. So when Jesus goes to Matthew's house, he said, get some more people like you. Bring them on in. And then bring other people that are way out there and set them in here too. Now, what I find interesting about that is nobody said anything about it but the Pharisees and the Sadducees, which I'm sorry to tell y'all are religious people. Religious people can't never get with Jesus kind hanging out with the world kind. You know, it's very hard to season food with salt if you leave the salt in the shaker. Y'all know I'm right about it. You got to take the salt out the shaker before it's going to season the food. I just kind of look at the church like that. We have gotten everybody in the house, and we've taught them to be so separate from those people out there that we have lost our effect on the very thing God came to save. It's so true. We're supposed to be the influence. And we spend so much time worrying about in church who's talking about us at church. We spend more time in gossip than we do in gospel. And I love Jesus Christ because he's radical. I mean, Jesus came shaking up everything. Everything that was religious, he shook up. He goes into the temple, turns tables over, starts moving stuff around. They were not used to that. And Jesus was just a cool guy who liked to hang out with people that drank wine. Read your Bible. Jesus had a reputation with sitting with wine bibbers. Now, I don't know what a bibber really is, but it sounds a little bit like somebody likes to drink a lot of wine. But he would hang out with these people, and it would just mess everybody up. I'm going to let that rest on you a little bit. I'm going to let y'all deal with that. So he is there. Now, here come the religious people. Now, for him to hear them, they had to be at least in the door. If they ain't got all the way in the house, they might have been all the way in the house. Because, you know, religious people going to lift their voice about what they feel is wrong. Why is your man talking to the disciples? Why is your man in here eating with sinners and wine drinking people? And people that take tax money. Bad mistake, because the Message Bible says it like this. I like this, David. By the way, congratulations. How long has it been? 9 years. And he leaned over to me, Yolanda, and said, it's been the best 9 years. I'm just helping him out a little bit with you. But they say, what is he doing in here with these sinners and tax collectors and whatnot? The Message Bible says Jesus heard it. And I like the way it says it. And he shot back. I like that too. I like that version, man. He didn't just hear it and let it rest. Jesus is one of those guys that speaks up for what he's about. Listen, the next time somebody see you down at the local lounge and then you in there talking about Jesus with somebody and they got something to say about it, shoot back and say exactly what Jesus said. Jesus said, who needs a doctor? The sick or the healthy? Boy, that's strong. Now, I believe it's more than just a shoot back. I believe it's more than a sarcastic response. I believe it's the heart of a Savior that has so much compassion, Sherry, for those people that are hurting. I believe that Jesus has a heart for people that are going through stuff. I don't think he was concerned about what they were eating or drinking. I think he was concerned about the condition of each one of those people's hearts. And when they mentioned that, he had to respond very quickly. Because when you are in your purpose and you are doing what God has called you to do, you don't have time to entertain foolishness. Let me help y'all with haters. Haters gonna hate. Let them hate. You just do what God tells you to do. Can you say amen to that? Now let me get into this just for a minute. I'm sorry. So I'm walking today. And I'm thinking about this verse of scripture. This verse came to me and DJ. I don't know if DJ got the revelation, but I got the revelation. And you know, Kendra, my daughter, talks to herself a lot. I'd be in the living room, she in there doing the dishes, and I hear her talking sometimes. I have to walk over there and look around. And I'm like, Kendra, you all right, baby? Yeah, I'm just talking to myself. Now, don't act like y'all don't do it. And don't act like y'all don't sing in the shower either. I can see some of y'all in y'all car right now just singing. But anyway, I'm walking. I got this verse of scripture in my mind. And I'm telling you, when I walk, the Lord starts speaking to me, impressing stuff on me. So as I'm thinking about this, here's the words I hear. And I'm just going to give it to you right like it's on my phone as I'm putting it on my little notepad as I'm walking. This is exactly how it came out. The purpose of healing is not just to fix the problem. Okay? The purpose of healing is not just to fix the problem. So what did Jesus identify at the table? The healthy don't need to be whole. What is his goal? Wholeness. The sick need the doctor. And when you do the etymology on the word sick, it's a plethora of definitions. But one of those is this, Pastor D, those who are in any kind of pain. So I hear this. The purpose of healing is not just to fix the problem. The purpose of healing is to fix the person. I'm coming. The purpose of healing is wholeness. Let's say that together. The purpose of healing is wholeness. He made that statement at that table. I've got a goal for everybody at this table to get them to a place of being whole. I believe we use the altar far too many times for God to touch our problem but not change our life. We want him to be our aspirin or our Tylenol or our Advil. We don't really want him to be the answer for everything. I just need you, God, right now. So the purpose of healing is wholeness. The purpose of healing is to move you from fragmentation to integration. Okay? From brokenness to wholeness. That's the purpose of healing. Then I hear these words, Kevin. Healing starts when we stop entertaining the hurt. I'm just giving it to you like it came to me on my phone. All right? Healing starts when we stop entertaining the hurt. Listen to me. Pain is not your friend. Okay? So pain don't show up to live with you. God will use pain to get your attention. Some people are so used to their hurt that they talk from their hurt. They see from their pain because they will never just give their pain to God and say, Lord, take it all. Are y'all with me so far? All right. So healing starts when you stop entertaining the hurt. Let me just work on that a little while longer because I feel comfortable in it. Some people rather talk about their pain than anything in the world. And they want you to know just how much they're hurting. Now listen, I can deal with you the first four times. I'm going to give you four times. You say, Bishop, why four? I don't know. That's just my number with pain, four times. So you come down, I'm dealing with it, and then I see you next time. I just can't get over it. And I'm still feeling you. 4 months go by. I ain't talked to you in 4 months. I see you. Third time. And you still talking about something that happened 2 years ago. When you come to me the fourth time and it's been 3 years, I'm going to do you this way. Talk to the hand. Some of y'all are like, Bishop, you being for real? Yeah. Right now, some of you are getting offended. Here's how you can know somebody's hurt. When you talk about a subject and they do this. Am I right about it? I'll give you an example. People that's been hurt with their money. You talk about tithe? Baby, I believe it's time to go. You start talking about an issue, and they respond, they react. That's how you know you're not healed. Don't make me go here. You know, I'm going to just flow. Is this all right, Pastor D, if I just flow what I feel? Do y'all not remember Joshua chapter number 3? They come over. They go in to take a city, and they can't take it. Right? You remember that? Because somebody stole a little something. And God said, it's all mine. Achan. We're talking about Achan and his family. At Ai. Woo, man, I'm feeling this thing here. God said, I know what y'all problem is. Y'all ain't never, we're going to circumcise everybody. Now, men just reacted right there a little bit different than women did. Read the Bible. That's another problem with church. We ain't real enough in church. We just sugarcoat stuff for y'all and, no, man, listen, this is real stuff. So watch what God does. He inflicts pain and then tells everybody, don't you move. Stay in one spot till you are completely whole. Too many people tracking through life carrying pain and hurt and wondering why they can't go forward. And wondering why they can't progress in life. Because you've never sat down and let God completely heal you of everything. Somebody talk back to me. This is a participatory service. Too many people, you can't go forward while you're in that kind of pain. Sit down. Let God work on you. Healing is the initiation that puts you on the path of wholeness. So healing is only the beginning. Wholeness is the goal. Right? So we must first get to a place where we are willing to make the pain part of our purpose. Ooh, rest, Bishop, right there and talk to these people. Quit acting like it didn't happen. When we say get over the pain, we ain't telling you don't act like it didn't happen. Pull it all up in your life and realize the pain that you've gone through is a great platform to reach people that's going through the same pain you have been through yourself. So whatever you've been through, incorporate it into your life. Why, Bishop? Because all things work together. Romans 8:28. For the good of those that love God and are thee called according to his purpose. Are you taking a picture, Debbie, or are you videoing me? You taking a picture of that? Don't be holding up like that. Put it up there again. Try it again. I'm bad messing with you. So watch this. Here's what I've learned. Ezekiel said, now I can sit where they sit. Why? Because I've gone through what they've gone through. Dan, nothing, Sharice, bothers me more than hearing preachers that act like they ain't never had no pain in their life. I don't need to see Superman. I want to see Clark Kent. I want to see a real man that has been through hell in his life, survived it, and says to people, if God brought me through it, then he can surely bring you through. If God healed me and made me whole, he can surely heal you and make you whole. Why would you keep your testimony a secret? Pull your pain into your present and tell your pain, you're going to work with me and you're going to work for me, and we're going to reach a lot of people that have to deal with you. So anytime pain shows up in your life, don't get mad. Say, hey, man, where you been? You about to go to work for me. You're going to feel it, but God's going to transform it. Amen. Amen. Communicating through pain is effective, but not as effective as communicating from pain. Now, what does that statement mean? Preaching out of pain, or speaking or communicating to people when you're in the midst of your pain, is effective to get their empathy or their sympathy. But when you can communicate with people from pain, in other words, it's in your past, then it doesn't pull sympathy out of them, it puts healing in them. I'll leave that there. People tend, now here we go with relationships. This just giving it to you like I got it. People tend to perpetuate pain through communicating pain that inflicts pain. Y'all got to think about that. You hear me, Pastor Norris? People tend to perpetuate pain through communicating pain that inflicts pain. The question is, why would you do that? Because you do not realize you have built a place where you are comfortable and feel effective. Woo! Watch this. In other words, you take two people, they get married, they lovely, everything just lovely, never had an argument, it's just beautiful. First place, don't ever get married till you fight. First of all, I need to see you mad. Am I telling the truth? First of all, I need you to get mad. Because I ain't waiting to say I do. And then you wake up like the Incredible Hulk trying to beat on my head. Helping somebody. So watch now. One day they're going along, a disagreement shows up, and they manifest. You're like, oh, I didn't know you had that in you. You were sweet like sugar. You look like Frankenstein. And you acted like a Tasmanian devil. And you're like, okay, where did that come from? You hid that quite well. So look, before y'all do any I do's, I will's, or I am, or anything else, just go ahead and get them mad. Y'all think I'm playing, and I ain't playing. Okay, so watch this. Just say, you know, they go on with it. Now we're in relationship, full-blown relationship. Something happens, sets few people off. All right, watch. Once you break that wall and insulation of respect, y'all better listen to the bishop. Once that is cracked and damaged, and you can and you are allowed to speak to someone in a disrespectful way, do you realize how long it takes, Kelvin, to go back and put them bricks back in place to start that insulation process over where there is a veil of respect? Y'all thinking about it right now. Some of y'all going back to your very first fight. Why? Because now I felt like I was effective in communicating to you, screaming at you. How? Because that's the first time I got your attention. So now in my mind, I'm saying this is what it takes to get reaction from you. So then they react back to you like you spoke to them. Then you react. Now what are we doing? Communicating. Better than you do at the dinner table asking how your day was. It lasts longer. Talk to me. It don't end quickly. You started the argument hour and a half later. You still fighting. Why? Because you comfortable. You don't reside in places you're not comfortable. Talk to me. You stay there because you feel effective there. With your voice raised and you screaming and calling one another names you ought not be calling one another. You're comfortable there, and that's why you stay there. I came to encourage all of you, stop inflicting pain on people that love you. And listen to me. Quit acting like it's normal. It's not normal to talk to people like that. Now get that in your mind right now. For real, y'all. For real. It's not normal to call people names. It's not normal to scream at people. I'm not even talking about God. I'm just talking about common sense. I'm just talking about normality. 2017 is the year of communication, right? The year of the overcomer. Pay, P-E-Y, 17th letter Hebrew alphabet, the area of the mouth, how you communicate. God is all on us every day this year about how we communicate with people. You know what I learned, Reuben? Hurt people do what? Hurt people. That's right. So before you open your mouth, get healed. Come on, y'all. I'm trying to help you tonight. Get healed. Before you say anything, be sure you're speaking from a place of wholeness. I thought about moving on from there, but I'm not. I'm going to stay right here. That old saying, sticks and stones may what? But what? That's a lie. There ain't nothing can hurt you like words. Words are so powerful that God used them to form the world. He formed the world by the words of his mouth. Words are that powerful. And if they can form, can't they certainly destroy? Would you do me a favor? Would you pray with me right now? Yes. Just repeat after me and say, Dear Lord,
I ask you
to forgive me for inflicting pain
on anyone
with the words of my mouth.
And Lord,
I ask you
to help me
fortify me
to the point
that I refuse
to allow anyone
to damage me
anymore
with the words of their mouth.
I am healed
and I am whole
and
I will speak from that place
in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thinking about stopping right there. Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth who went about healing. You can just stop there. You know what it takes to heal? It takes balm, B-A-L-M. It takes substance to heal. Did you hear what I just said? You can't bring healing without substance. We all have so much substance attached to the character of who we are on this earth that anywhere we go, we're offering healing to every person in our presence. We're healing agents. And that's how Jesus lived his life. We won't go there, but I'll refer to it if you don't mind. When you get to Mark chapter 5, The Bible says in Mark chapter 5, around verse 25, that there was a woman who had an issue. Specifically an issue of blood. And the Bible says she could be healed of no man. But she said within herself, if I can touch the hem of his garment, I will be what? Not healed. She didn't want to be healed. The word issue means a current or something revolving, something that is perpetuated in your life. All of us in here have issues. Be real about it. But our issues are different. You don't have the same issues I have, which means you don't have the same propensities or tendencies, or you may not. You might. But I bet if we really broke it down and we went around this room and says, what's the issue you have to deal with mostly in your life? It's going to be so diverse. By the time we get to the other side of the room, you'll be shocked at what you're hearing. Because the more we talk, the more we're going to open up. Because that's what communication does. So she's got an issue. And some people got so many issues, they need a magazine rack. I see. I couldn't help it. So issues are things we have to deal with, right? And she said, if I can touch his garment. She didn't even say, I want to touch Jesus. She just said, I want to, like Pastor D always preaches this, I just want to touch something that's touching him. Could that be you? Aren't you in touch with him? Then shouldn't I be able to touch you and feel virtue? Because you're touching him. If I can just touch something that's touching him, I'll be healed. Jesus is on his way to heal somebody else. A 12-year-old girl who had died. Right? To raise her from the dead. And he stops the parade and says, somebody touch me. Now, you know the disciples said, Lord, there's a lot of people touching you right now. But here's what he said. No, somebody touch me because virtue just went out of me. Let me ask you another question. When is the last time you allowed virtue to flow through you? You know those times we pray in church, we say, join hands with your neighbor? That's a good chance to just allow faith to go through you. It not only causes energy, it causes synergy, which means we're all feeling the other person. Oh, man, this is good. So he turns around, and the first time in his life, Gene, he calls somebody daughter. He didn't say lady. He said, daughter, your faith has made, it didn't heal you. It made you whole, which means not only that issue, but every issue in your life just shifted. I need somebody to talk to me tonight. I'm telling you, I believe God is getting us to a place that we think we bring in one issue and God says, no, I'm going to deal with all your issues. All the way since you was a child. The pain you felt as a child all the way to the day you're living in right now. I'm going to heal all of that. Oh, Lord. Y'all want me to show you how many pages? I taught that page. Come here, Pastor Norris. Show them the pages we didn't teach. So they know. See, we didn't touch 2, 3, 4. Seven pages we didn't touch. We touch one. One. I ain't going to keep going because y'all won't come back next week. I'm messing with you. Just let me say this. There's one thing we all have in common. We've all been hurt. You say, Bishop, big old burly man like you, I remember one of the worst pains I ever felt. I'd just gone through divorce, and as all you know, it was everywhere. And I walked into Alamo Cafe by myself, and I sat down, praying I wouldn't see anyone I knew. Kind of kept my head down, had a baseball cap on. And Tony, I decided to look up. There was a table full of people, about six of them. I knew them all. They used to go to my church. And when I looked up, they were all looking at me. Raised their hand, got the ticket. Very quickly, and I stood up because I wanted to go say hi, and they wouldn't. And I thought, how can you be like that? Because there's going to be a day in your life that you're going to be hurting like I'm hurting, and you're going to need somebody to at least shake your hand and say, I'm praying for you. At bare minimum. I'll never forget that pain. Here's the difference in pain. April, 11 to 15% of people in any group you're in are suffering from some kind of physical pain. And that's a true stat. 11 to 15%. So you know what that tells me, Pastor D? 10%, 11, 15% of people in this room have some kind of physical pain. Now watch this. 30% at minimum of people in any group is hurting from some kind of emotional pain. And I question today, why is that? And it hit me. If you break your arm, it's going to hurt, isn't it? The doctor's going to put a cast on it, and what is he going to give you? A timeline, an expectation. And he's going to say, by this date, you should be fine. We're going to take the cast off on this date. By this date, you'll be fine. You won't even feel it anymore. And the only way you will feel it is if you entertain phantom pain. And for you to entertain phantom pain, you have to go through psychological gymnastics to get there, which means you have to relive the experience. If physical pain is on a timeline, emotional pain, soul pain, does not operate according to timelines. So it can happen to you when you're 7 years old by somebody you loved and respected, and they violated you and they hurt you deeply, and you're 40 years old and you can go there in your mind and it hurts you today at 40 like it did when you were seven, because emotional pain don't have a time attached to it. There's only one answer. There's only one remedy. And that's for Jesus Christ to touch you and make you whole. Can you say amen to that? I text these guys today, and I said, I want y'all to sing this song tonight. And they were singing it when I walked in. And I want them to sing it again. And as they sing it, I want it to mean something a little different to you this time. Make it personal. I believe You are my healer. I believe you are my portion. I believe, Jesus, you are all I need. Why? Because you hold my world. Would you stand up and lift those hands, please? Just lift those hands and let's sing this, please. Yes. Sing that verse to you. Just lift those hands and let these words heal you tonight.
You hold my every moment.
He does.
You calm my raging sea.
Yes, God.
You walk with me through fire.
Ask you this, would you be so brave as to bring your pain to the Lord tonight? Now let me explain myself. I'm going to ask you to come to this altar and let the Lord touch you, because he's what you need. He's what you need. But when you come, I don't want you to bring your problem only, but bring you. Because he does not want to just fix the problem. He wants to fix the person. He don't want to just temporarily give you relief for something you're dealing with. He wants to change your entire life. So if you would have the courage and the faith, Eric, I want you to sing that. I think there's a second verse if you know it. If there's not, just sing the first one again. But as she does, and they sing with her, would you please... Look, people will let you walk by. They will let you get through and come down here. Because there's virtue in this altar tonight. And I'm believing the Lord, you're going to leave here made whole tonight. You're going to leave here made whole. Go ahead, Erica. Hallelujah. Would you come right now? Nothing is impossible for God. Would you come tonight? Nothing.
Nothing is impossible.
Nothing.
Nothing is impossible.
Look at Bishop James. Look at me. Come on, you can do it. Come here, man. Come here. I don't know what you're going through, man, but I can tell you it caught you suddenly and it hit you hard. But there's some men behind you that love you very much. There's a church that stands with you. God's not healing you tonight. He's making you whole tonight. You know what I want y'all to do? Just if you'll just follow my instruction, I promise you the Lord will do a great thing. I want y'all to very softly sing, "I believe that you're my healer." That part of that song, that whole part. Very softly. And then here's what I want. You leaders that are out there, ministers, elders, I want you to come forward. You know, men, come and just pray for men. If people are uncomfortable with you standing in front of them, praying for them, that's okay. You don't have to do that. But let somebody hear you praying for them tonight. Could you guys come, please, and just let somebody hear you praying? Amen. Would you come just close enough to, "Lord, heal my sister." Just pray like that. "Lord, heal my sister. Heal my brother." Heal them first, Lord, and ultimately make them whole. We pray for their wholeness tonight, Jesus, because we believe you want us to be whole people. Can you pray loud enough that they can hear you praying for them?